morning friends, welcome to this edition of VBS Anatoma. We are beginning a series of video lectures on the topic gross anatomy of the liver. As you know, this is a very important abdominal organ with a lot of clinical importance and relations all around it. Now, in the part one of this series, we will have an overview of its location and its orientation, where it is, what are quadrants of the abdomen it covers, what is its shape, and you know, important structures in its near vicinity. Now, let's map it in the abdomen using these abdominal quadrants. As you see in this photograph, I have outlined the liver. You can see it's an infradiaphragmatic location on the right side. But when we look at it, its area that it occupies in terms of its mapping on the abdominal quadrants, it seems to have quite a bit of extent. Of course, it goes without saying that the right hypochondrium is the major area, no doubt about that, but then that's where the right lobe is fully located. But then the lobe also extends into the epigastrium. Below the right hypochondrium, into the right lumbar, some amount of it. Then small end of the or the tip of the left lobe extends into the left hypochondrium, and of course the epigastrium, and of course the umbilical region. Next, when we look at the liver and its adjacent structures and map it on the anterior abdominal wall, we seem to get a more clearer idea of its location. Let's try to identify as many structures as is possible in this photograph. Of course, the right lobe we have already identified. That's the larger, the huge part of the lung, of the liver. Right above it, separated only by the right dome of the diaphragm, is the right lung. See its immediate superior relation. That's very, very important, especially for clinical purposes. When you need to pass a needle to take a biopsy, you have to be extremely careful because of the lung that covers it from the, not only at the superior aspect, but also to some extent on its right aspect. Next, the base of the heart, I have already told you, is the next one, just adjacent to the right lung, and the central tendon is separating it from the liver. Also note the close relation of the lower chest cage on the right side. This is very important. Also, there is some amount of the diaphragm on the left side also is important, especially in relation to the left lobe, separates it from the left lung. Although it's not as extensive as in the right side, but certainly it has to be added to the discussion. The stomach, immediately below onto the right of the, to the left of the liver, right colic flexure, and the adjacent transverse colon, immediately below on the inferior surface. Now you see, when I give a blow up photograph of the abdominal cavity with the liver removed, you just like we have a stomach bed, There seems to be something similar in concept for the liver, although it's not really mentioned in textbooks. Let's try to identify the structures in the abdominal cavity or the retroperitoneal region when the liver is removed. You see, the fibers of the diaphragm, the muscle fibers of the diaphragm, particularly the right lobe of the diaphragm, D1, the duodenum first part, taking a turn and beginning into the second part is there. Next, the right kidney and the right suprarenal, immediately behind the duodenum. These are all important structures, which virtually they are all inferior relations or the relations of the visceral surface of the liver. Of course, I have already mentioned the right colic flexure. Next, let's move on to the cadaver. Here is a specimen from the torso of the cadaver, the anterior abdominal wall and the corresponding anterior thoracic wall has been removed. You can see more or less the same structures I showed you in the model in the previous slides. Let's quickly recall the right lung, the superior surface of the liver, the basal surface of the heart, inferior border of the liver, the diaphragm, you can see the muscle fibers of the diaphragm, stomach immediately to the left and below the liver, particularly the left lobe of the liver. Next, as already shown in the model, the transverse colon and the hepatic flexure, I repeat, hepatic flexure. Now, although we are not going into a detailed discussion in this particular part one of the video about the inferior surface, we cannot continue the discussion without making a mention of porta hepatis, because it is a very key structure on the inferior aspect. It's an entry point into the liver. You see, this is the only entry point into the substance of the liver. The other entry point is at the back, but then it's more an exit point rather than an entry point concept wise. That is the hepatic veins coming out of the liver. But then on this surface, in discussion, that is inferior surface, there is only one and only one inlet, namely the porta hepatis. It is the inlet to the liver. You see, there are a lot of structures. We will go through it in detail in the next video, where the inferior surface gets a wider coverage. Nevertheless, it is appropriate here to mention that the portal vein and the hepatic artery enter through the porta, and the bile duct emerges from the porta hepatis. Now, that's the inferior border. That's the gallbladder. Not only related, it is plastered to the undersurface of the liver, and you can also see the ligamentum teres over there, a structure of very significant embryological importance. Now, you see, this is yet another cadaver photograph. You can see the superior surface of the right lobe of the liver has been particularly cleaned and exposed. I am holding the falciform ligament with my left hand. You see, that's the falciform ligament, and that is the right lobe of the liver. Further down below, you can see the cut ends of the ribs and the cut intercostal muscles. Now, this is actually in situ, the inferior surface of the liver. It's located in situ. It is not disturbed, but the structures in its vicinity has been cleaned. Left lobe, gallbladder, D1, right lobe. Now, once again, because of increasing reliance on imaging modalities, no discussion of abdominal structures is complete without a reference to cross-sectional anatomy. Therefore, here is a horizontal section passing through the liver. You can see some important structures. Although the section is through the thoracic cavity, but then remember the thoracic cage is visible. But then we are at a junction where a horizontal section at this point also gives it gives a little bit of the thoracic cavity contents. It also gives a little bit of the abdominal cavity content. That means we are in the plane where the diaphragm is located. Right from the upper end of the diaphragm to the lower costal attachments, that area will give you a little of both cavities. As in this case, you can see, for example, that's the right lobe of the liver. I repeat, right lobe of the liver. Now, behind it, you can see the small part that is the lung. That's the lung of the right, that's the right lung, I would say. Next, the cross section of the stomach. Remember, this cross section we are viewing from the inferior aspect. We are viewing it from the inferior aspect. Next, in front, you can see the heart, the cross section of the ventricular area. Now, this is a section much more lower down in the thoracoabdominal region. You can still see the thoracic cage at the borders, but the location is much down. You can see the size of the liver has increased. You can see the huge right lobe, and you can see a small part of the left lobe also here. Next, stomach increased in size. Probably we are at the region where the esophagus is opening into the stomach. That means probably that's the cardioesophageal junction. You can see the esophagus right in front of the vertebra there. Probably this is the first lumbar vertebra. Now that's the thoracic cage. Now, having got the orientation, let's look into some actual imaging modalities. We always begin with a plain X-ray of the abdomen. You can see I have in dotted lines given a brief mapping of the liver in this photograph, keeping that as the template, as the anchor. You see lower thoracic wall on the right side, dome of the right diaphragm, left diaphragm dome, heart. Now we'll continue without that marking, because by now we are familiar where the liver is. Right lobe of the liver, right lung, stomach particularly identified infradiaphragmatically on the left side because of the fundal gas shadow. Costodiaphragmatic recess of the on the right side is important, as I told you earlier, because that is at the junction of the liver and the lung, separated only by the diaphragm. A needle passed along a horizontal line in this region will bypass the lung, and through the diaphragm you can directly hit the right lobe of the liver. Next, this is a CT scan. Although it's not meant for the liver, it's probably meant for the kidney, probably a cystic disease of the kidney. Nevertheless, the liver is seen, and to that extent we will focus on the liver. That's the right lobe of the liver. You can see the vertebra in the middle. This is a oblique section, but for all discussion purposes we will treat it as a coronal section. You can see the vertebral column, the lumbar region, and you can see the paravertebral muscles on either sides. The psoas, I would say, particularly well seen on this side and that side. Then, because I mentioned the right kidney, I'm just showing you the location of the kidney. Looks, yes, there is a lot of cystic changes. Probably it is a cystic, polycystic kidney, could be, but then the focus is not on the kidney but on the liver. Yet another CT cross section showing the liver in in a better, a larger cross section. The right lobe is particularly huge. Once again, here is a horizontal section, and we are viewing the mapped image from the inferior aspect. Next, the right kidney. Now, this is a sagittal section, rather maybe slightly parasagittal. You can see the lumbar vertebrae, and you can see the cross section of the liver. The superior surface, the anterior surface are particularly well seen. Next, the right kidney. Now, that was an overview of two aspects of the liver. Its location, that means where it is present, which quadrants it occupies in the abdomen, and orientation, how it is present, what is its shape. And to some extent, to improve the understanding, its important relations. I haven't discussed it extremely in detail, but this is an introductory video for the rest of the gross anatomy of the liver. More videos will follow. Thank you for your patient listening.